Hello and welcome to Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Kelly, your traveling host. I'm in Iowa today. If you happen to be watching on the video, you can see right behind me, Iowa Catholic Radio Network. They've been so gracious to host me and talking with Joe Heschmeyer, 2 hours open forum with Joe Heschmeyer, who is, I just found out, only like 2.5 hours driving distance away from me. So, Joe, open forum, by the way, call with any question you've got. You don't have to be Catholic to call. If you've got a question about the faith, maybe you've got a question, a general question about God or about Jesus or the Bible. Maybe you have a specific question about particular doctrine or teaching or Bible passage. All welcome here, 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884. Joe, my fellow Midwesterner, welcome. Thanks for being here.
Yeah, I'm the, Kansas City's kind of the San Diego to your Los Angeles up there, about 3 hours south, you know? It's kind of checks out.
Yeah, it's not that. You're right. I asked somebody how far. It's amazing, and this will make a fascinating conversation, because nothing fascinates like drive times. But I asked someone the drive time to Chicago from here, and it's less than from my house to San Francisco. So, there, Joe.
Okay, here's the other thing. Midwesterners love talking drive time. I want to give couple accurate Midwestern stereotypes. One, we love describing distances in minutes or hours, because traffic isn't enough of a variable. You know, like, you can't really do that in L.A. Like, my wife's family, I always say they're from, like, an hour north of L.A., but sometimes they're 3 hours north of L.A., depending on how the traffic is.
Right.
And, you know.
Yeah.
But here, we use time as a distance of measurement. It's like in space. And second, an accurate Midwestern stereotype that I was really struck by, I was just down in Camdenton, Missouri, in the Lake of the Ozarks area, and I was working at a coffee shop, and suddenly really good bluegrass broke out because there were a bunch of old timers who just got together and started playing bluegrass. And this is maybe the, I don't know, dozenth time this has happened to me in my life, where I'll be somewhere in the Midwest working or eating or doing something at a, you know, McDonald's or a coffee shop or whatever. And randomly, you just get great bluegrass music. And it's always just like these retirees who are very gifted. And I just think of all of the often inaccurate stereotypes I see of the Midwest. I would love to see one media depiction that accurately captured just how bizarre and delightful this feature is. I mean, imagine if you were just like in San Diego and suddenly like mariachi music just broke. I mean, I should say
that does actually happen
in San
Joe.
Diego.
Yes. Yeah.
So this, you know, bluegrass is just Midwestern mariachi.
Well, the only stereotype I know of Midwestern people is, that they haven't lost their morals. That's the only thing that I feel like in the West Coast we know for sure about Midwestern people is that they've maintained a moral standard. Not, I don't know what the moral standard is, but they've still got one.
Yeah, I mean, it's only by comparison. If you, I mean, this is one of the unfortunate areas where the stereotype is maybe better than the reality. You know, I know Hillbilly Elegy is a really controversial book, and it's about Appalachia rather than the Midwest, but it points to some real stats, which is like things like church going are way down in the Midwest and in Appalachia and in the South. Like these places that are these traditional, you know, Bible Belt, etc. kind of strongholds are actually suffering a lot more. But because that suffering is really dwarfed by, if I can be so blunt, the insanity we sometimes see from the coasts, it can often seem like this really pleasant reprieve by comparison. But if you stop the comparison between the coast and the Midwest, you realize and just compare like the Midwest to a generation ago, things are getting worse.
Oh,
they're just getting worse slower.
You know, I feel like the Holy Spirit prepared for this by starting these Catholic radio networks that are springing up all around the country. I feel like, you know, there is this way in which everywhere is a victim now of what the media kind of wildness that we have everywhere, the still adjusting to social media, young kids having their faith challenged at a very young age on social media. And then right in the midst of that, popping up everywhere are these Catholic radio networks like Iowa Catholic Radio. And I really feel that way. Like when you get to visit, you feel like, the people are making a huge difference with these Catholic radio networks everywhere.
Yeah, this is a great double-edged sword of communication. I was a comm minor in college, And I'm always struck by something Marshall McLuhan said about how basically every communication device is a two-edged sword. So, you know, getting work emails on your phone is both liberating because you don't have to be in the office, but it's also enslaving because now even if you're at the beach, you're still at the office. And so everything is kind of this double-edged sword. And so often we focus on just the negative side. We say, oh, look, all of these communications are making us dumber. They're making us have shorter attention spans. There's temptations to things like pornography. There's all sorts of negative resources out there. And what's more, you can just become overwhelmed with despair because you're seeing all of the bad news in the world right in front of you all at once, which humans were not made for that kind of, you know, that's a God's eye view of the evils of the world. And you're not ready for that. But the flip side to that is, we also have access to, like, the entire treasure trove of the church's wisdom, not just the catechism. Yeah. You've got the writings of literally thousands of saints. You've got live resources where if you've got any esoteric kind of theological question, there's a good chance you can find it. And if you can't, you can throw your question out into the void, and there's a good chance someone will answer it. And so whether we're talking about the internet or whether we're talking about Catholic radio, these communication media that we can often focus on the negative side to them. God wants to redeem these. God wants to use these things as places in which to spread the gospel. We can't just concede them to the enemy.
Amen, brother. And there's a whole bunch of people waiting to cast their question, not to the void, but to you, Joe. So how about we head to the phones?
Yeah, let's do it.
All right, it's open forum. You ask whatever you like. Joe Heschmeyer, our guest. The number is 888-318-7884, and we start out with one of our fellow Midwesterners, Megan in Wisconsin, watching on YouTube. Megan, go ahead with your question for Joe.
Hello, Cy and Joe. My question is, how do we respond to, like, the Protestant claim of that, you know, if Mary hadn't sinned, you know, she couldn't die, you know, the wages of sin are death. So how do we kind of respond to that claim? And then also, Joe, I'm really enjoying the podcast so far, so I'm looking forward to more episodes.
Oh, you know what? I'm really glad you said that, because I had instructions to plug the podcast, and 8 minutes in, I'd already forgotten about that. So anyone listening, there's a new podcast by yours truly called Shameless Popery. An easy way to find it is just go to shamelessjoe.com, and it'll give you a link to it, or you can go to shamelessjoe.com. So to the question, if Mary's sinless, why did she die? Well, I think we can say that Mary voluntarily participates in things that she could be exempt from. And we have that on good scriptural evidence. And by that, I mean, if you look after the birth of Jesus, Mary goes and offers a sin offering in the temple. But if you go back and look at the law, the sin offering was to be offered by one who had received seed. That's the actual language. So it's the woman who, after intercourse, conceives and bears a child, she offers the sin offering. Well, Mary, who is immaculately conceived, who is giving birth to the sinless Savior, and who is having a virgin birth, was not under the law by the terms of the law. Even if you don't believe in the Immaculate Conception, just the fact that this is a virgin birth means Mary wouldn't have been obliged to offer the sin offering, and yet she does. And so likewise, Jesus submits himself to the law, even though he's the lawgiver. That Jesus gives us this model of submitting even if you could stand on your rights. This is an important distinction, not just for understanding Mary and Jesus, but even understanding the role of Christians. That you have the ability to disobey an unjust law, like civil law, but there are times when it's better to submit even to an unjust law. St. Paul says, why not let yourself get robbed? That there are times where litigating or standing on your rights is worse than just suffering an injustice. And so Mary seems to be completely in this Christian model that she dies. Most people think, you know, this is not something we dogmatically hold one way or the other, whether she undergoes death. We just know that at the end of her life, the East celebrates the dormition, the falling asleep of Mary, combined with her assumption. And so the theological consensus in most of the church is that Mary does die before the assumption. But this is not something the church teaches. So just to be clear. But if she does die, that doesn't disprove her sinlessness, just as her offering the sin offering in the temple doesn't disprove her sinlessness, and it doesn't disprove the virgin birth. Does that make sense that Mary, Jesus, and good Christians voluntarily submit to the law even when they could be exempt from it?
Yeah, that makes sense to me. Yeah, I was just kind of wondering how we would, you know, respond to someone who would make that claim. So that's great.
Great.
Well, Megan, thanks. Thanks for starting us off on what has so far been an all Midwest edition of Catholic Answers Live. Megan calling from Wisconsin. I'm in Iowa. Joe's south down there in Kansas City. And we'll take a quick break. Be right back with more Open Forum with Joe Heschmeyer on Catholic Answers Live.
Catch Catholic Answers Live anytime at Catholic.com.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects home buyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
Are you a coffee drinker? If so, you can now enjoy a coffee roasted to perfection by the Carmelite Monks of Wyoming. Delicious Mystic Monk coffee is roasted and prepared by monks in a hidden cloistered monastery and is available in over 25 varieties. All Mystic Monk coffees are works of perfection and labors of love. For more information on how to purchase Mystic Monk coffee, visit mysticmonkcoffee.com. That's mysticmonkcoffee.com.
The most original and exclusive Catholic content is on EWTN Radio.
I'm continually amazed and humbled at the way God can work through me to help so many people. Although I have no idea what the caller's questions will be that day, I trust that the Holy Spirit can use my education and experience to guide, challenge, or comfort those who call.
Mast Appeal with Colleen Kelly Mast. Saturday morning, 9 Eastern on EWTN Radio.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Kellett, your host. Joe Heschmeyer is our guest, and it is open forum today. Your call is welcome, 888-318-7884. You don't have to be Catholic to call. We love talking about the Catholic faith with anybody who's got a question or just wants to talk about the Catholic faith. And thus far, it's been an all-Midwest show because I'm super proud of myself. I don't know why I'm proud of this fact. I didn't actually invent the Midwest, but I'm in the Midwest today. I'm in the studios of Iowa Catholic Radio, where they've been very, very kind to let us do the broadcast today. And up next is Joe. Also, I think if you're in North Dakota, you're in the Midwest. I don't know if
that is solidly Midwestern, yes.
Is that solid no, Midwest? All right. I don't know where the West
it's
starts.
Central
I guess the
time
Rockies.
Zone is- Yeah, it's like
North. You go by time zone. Yeah, I should know that as a Midwesterner. I should know that. Joe, in Fargo, are you there with us?
Yeah.
Hello, Joe. How old are you?
I'm 11.
Well, thank you very much for your call. We're glad you're here. Go ahead with your question for Mr. Heschmeyer.
Okay. In the book of Genesis, around Noah's time, they talk about how the angels came down and they had offspring with us, and they called them the Nephilim. I've never really heard anything about the Nephilim, and I want to know like what they are and all that.
Yeah, this is a really controversial question. You're not giving me an easy one here, Joe. So in Genesis 6, there's this group Nephilim, which is like it's a plural. And it's said that they are the produced from the sons of God and the daughters of men. And we're told that these were the mighty men of old, the men of renown. And so there's a couple different understandings of this. One is there's kind of a trajectory in the early books of Genesis where lifespans get shorter and shorter. And it's a symbol of just the way sin is making a bigger and bigger kind of inroad, that you have holy people becoming less holy and you have unholy people becoming even unholier, if you make that a word. And so this one reading of this is that this is another sign of that the daughters of men are the unholy, the sons of God are the holy, that it's a sign of like the intermarriage between holy and unholy people. And so these mighty men of old, if you look at the surrounding nations in Israel's time, they would have all these myths about the great heroes of old. And Genesis seems to be saying, yeah, the great heroes of old weren't that great. There was actually this kind of downward movement where from Adam's time onward, sin got worse and worse. You start with Adam and Eve rebelling once from God, And then you immediately have Cain and Abel and murder very quickly within a generation. And then you just get this increasing chaos until you get to Genesis 6, where you get basically the recreation of the world, the washing of the world with water. And this washing of the world with water is actually a kind of symbol of what God's going to do in the New Testament with baptism. So in 1 Peter 3, St. Peter talks about this, that this is a symbol of baptism which now saves you. In other words, like, sin gets worse and worse and worse in the world, and we can see that around us. You know, it seems like things get worse and worse and worse. But God's always there to redeem and save us. And so, understood in that way, the Nephilim are a sign that these so-called mighty men of old weren't so great, that they're part of this downward trajectory, that God wants to do something new, this kind of work of regeneration and recreation. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I think so. Thanks.
Yeah, you bet.
Joe, thank you. I really appreciate that call. Appreciate you calling with that question. And man, we've just had some young people lately, Joe. They're just amazing. I don't know. They're just so mature. They're just so mature, a lot of these young people. It's very impressive.
I'm very impressed. It's worth thinking back to the questions you might have been asking at 11 and thinking, okay, I'm not going to despair. There's some really good signs. Okay.
Yeah.
I like where they're at compared to where I might have been at.
I don't know. I feel like when I was 11, there was probably some 11-year-olds who could be as mature as Joe. Just because I wasn't one of them, I don't want to condemn my entire generation.
That's very fair.
Shameless Potpourri is the new podcast that Joe was mentioning before, and you can get it at shamelessjoe.com, shamelessjoe.com. I hope you will. It's getting rave reviews, and I've actually seen some of them, and they really are rave reviews. But I didn't ask you, Joe, what just dropped? Because a new episode will drop each Thursday, I think is how you're doing
yes.
it. And I know that yep. you got one on the Reformation yesterday, but I haven't gotten a chance to listen to it, so tell me about it.
Yeah, so it was the second episode. The first episode we did was about what was the Bible like in Jesus' day. The second episode is on the radical nature of the Reformation. That sometimes you'll hear people say, oh, you know, Luther didn't mean to start his own church. He was just trying to reform. It's right there in the name Reformation. And when you actually go back and read Luther, it's actually really remarkable. So we were just talking about the days of Noah in Joe's question. And Luther compares himself to a new Noah. But what's really kind of shocking about this is he compares himself to a new Noah and compares the early Christians to the people of Noah's day that were so sinful that God like wipes them out. And so he really presents himself as the founder of a new religion. And when you read him in that light, it really hammers home how striking and how radical the Reformation is. That Luther and the other reformers do this as well, but I focus on Luther, will regularly have these moments where they basically say, everyone before me got this wrong, but I know I'm understanding the Bible correctly. And there's an arrogance to that that's really kind of shocking. You know, and I think people would recognize it if it happened today. If the guy down the street said, I'm starting a new form of Christianity because everyone before me got it wrong, you would say, that's a cult. That's crazy. That's not of God. And if Jesus founded Christianity, who are you to refound it? And so, you know, we would recognize that, for instance, in Mormonism and Islam and other places. But a lot of what the reformers were saying and doing was very much like that, saying, you know, nobody understood Christianity until me, or Christianity was understood by the first generation, but then nobody after that. And so we've got to redo it here in the 16th century. And there's this incredible hubris to it, especially when you look at all these areas in which modern Protestants would say, no, Luther actually got this one wrong, that went wrong, you know. I don't know any Protestants who agree with Luther on the Jews, that we should take away their synagogues and burn them down and, you know, lock up rabbis and commit all these like acts of anti-Semitic violence. You know, nobody agrees with him on those kind of obviously evil things or other areas where he damns anyone who denies purgatory. I don't know any Protestants who agree with that. And so if you say, okay, this guy thought he had Christianity all figured out, but everybody agrees that he's wrong in a bunch of areas, it starts with the Reformation in a different light than the way a lot of watered-down presentations of the Reformation kind of present it.
Check it out. It's Shameless Potpourri with Joe Heschmeyer, and you can get it at shamelessjoe.com. We're going to talk to Luke next, who's I think from Nigeria, watching on YouTube. Am I correct about that, Luke?
Yes, you're correct.
I thought this was you, Luke. This is our friend Luke from South Korea. But originally, World Traveling Luke, originally from Nigeria. Go ahead, Luke, with your question for Joe.
Good morning, Joe. Nice talking to you for the first time. And you're safe.
Oh, good evening.
Okay, so, Mr. Joe, my question is this. Does the will of God affect, does our prayers affect the will of God in our lives? And if not so, what is the importance of prayer?
That's a great question. The best biblical answer to that is in James 5, beginning in verse 13, and then really kicking off in a deeper way in verse 16, which says that the prayer of a righteous man has great power in its effects. And James gives the example of Elijah, who prays, and his prayers start a famine for 3.5 years, and then he prays again, and the heavens rained. That is very clearly, our prayers actually do something. Our prayers are not just about us feeling better about the will of God. Our prayers actually are part of God's will. And you see this in a really remarkable way in Matthew 6, that Jesus gives us the model of the Our Father, but he begins by telling us that our Father knows what we need before we even ask him, and yet we're still to pray. So how do we make sense of that? Well, it isn't that God doesn't know something and that we're telling him something, obviously. But it's rather that the will of God includes rewarding our prayer. And the example I give as a dad is when I say something like, if you finish your meal, you can have dessert. My will is accomplished if they then finish their meal and then they get dessert. That their finishing the meal actually does something. It produces a different outcome than if they don't finish their meal. But it doesn't mean my will was thwarted or changed. My will all along was, if you finish your meal, you'll have dessert. On the other hand, if they don't finish their meal, they won't have dessert. And my will is still accomplished. If you finish your meal, you'll have dessert. So we often think of the will of God as static, meaning not having any conditionals like if-thens in it. But God's eternal plan includes our free cooperation. So he gives these things where he says, if you pray for this, this will happen. If you don't pray for it, it won't happen. And he knows even how we're going to respond to that. But our response really does make a difference because our response is part of his will. Does that distinction make sense?
Yes. In the book of Exodus, God wanted to punish the children of Israel like so many times, and Moses intervened and asked God not to do that. Does that mean that, Moses changed the will of God, something like that?
It means that God's will was to have one outcome if Moses interceded, and maybe another outcome if Moses hadn't interceded. We get this even going back further to Genesis with Sodom and Gomorrah. God, we're told, presents, in Genesis 17, it's very clear that because God has chosen this special role for Abraham, he tells him the fate of Sodom and Gomorrah because he wants him to pray for Sodom and Gomorrah. He wants him to intercede for Sodom and Gomorrah. And though, even though there are not enough holy people for the cities entirely to be saved, Abraham's intercession does save Lot and his family. We're told that in Genesis 18. But God wasn't surprised by that. It wasn't that he had a bad idea and Abraham gave him a better idea. God's plan all along was to include the free cooperation of Abraham, of Moses, of Elijah, and of you and me.
Okay, Luke?
Okay. That is very understanding. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Luke. We always, I feel like we're so international when Luke calls. I wish we could send things to South Korea. I can't mail anything to South Korea, but you know what? Hang on, Luke. If you talk to Edgar, maybe we can give you a copy of Joe's book, The Early Church Was the Catholic Church, but we'll give it to you in electronic form. I can't promise it because I don't know if we can do that. But if we can do it, Edgar will make it happen. So hang on the line, Luke, because I'm always so grateful when you call. It makes us feel really important and international when you call. And the number here, 888-318-7884. Based here as we are in the Midwest, me and Joe, I'm in Iowa, and Joe's in Kansas City. Bianca's on the line now.
Can I say California. Real quick, Si?
Yeah,
you're a lot nicer now that you're Midwesterner.
I am a lot nicer. I think that's actually true. I'm nicer as a now that I've moved to the Midwest for one day. I think I am a nicer person. Do you know, Joe, in all seriousness, that happened to me. I've only been to Hawaii one time in my life, and I was a way nicer person in Hawaii because I said to my wife, they live aloha here, so I'm going to live aloha. And I was so nice living aloha. All right, we're going to get to Bianca in a second because I can hear the music. I forgot to watch the clock. We'll take a quick break. Bianca, hang on. We're happy to take your call from California, even though you live in California. We'll be right back with more Catholic Answers Live. Open Forum, Joe Heschmeyer.
Catholic Answers Live.
The recent decision by the U.S. Supreme Court to overturn Roe v. Wade was a monumental victory for the pro-life movement. But the fight is far from over. With our new booklet, Why We're Pro-Life, we have produced the perfect tool to prepare you to have peaceful and convincing conversations to shed light on the truth about human life from conception to natural death. Catholic Answers is printing millions of copies of this booklet, and we plan simply to give them away. You can help us in two ways. First, by generously supporting this project. 25 cents prints one book. $2,500 prints 10,000, and so on. Second, by helping us distribute the booklet through your parish, your school, or the pro-life ministry you work with. Catholic Answers is going to blanket the country with Why We're Pro-Life, but only if you step up and help us. Thank you so much. For more information, visit whyweareprolife.com.
Here's a question. Is it really possible to be friends with someone who died 2,000 years ago? Maybe the problem is that we've grown way too comfortable with the story of Jesus. Nice man, right? Taught us to love one another, said not to judge people. We celebrate his birthday every year. It's time to put away this small, safe version of Jesus, says Cy Kellett. Nobody that bland could have transformed the world. In A Teacher of Strange Things, Cy presents Jesus Christ undiluted by sentiment, with all his radical words and deeds uncensored. Do you know someone, your son or daughter perhaps, or maybe your mom or dad, who needs the friendship of Jesus Christ? Do you? Order your copy of A Teacher of Strange Things by visiting shop.catholic.com today or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Does the church have too many rules? Join me, Dr. David Anders, as we answer your questions right here on Call to Communion, Monday at 2 p.m. Eastern. Now, back to Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Kellett, your host. Much nicer than I usually am because I am in the Midwest today. And as Joe was pointing out, you just are nicer when you're in the Midwest. I'm not saying that to criticize our next caller, Bianca, from Clovis, California. I'm sure there are many nice people in California. But I'm a Midwesterner now, and that's just how I feel. Hi, Bianca. Got a question for Joe?
Hi. Hey, hi there. Yes, very nice here in Clovis. I also wanted to say thank you both for your work. I wish you both you and your family very Merry Christmas.
Thank you, Bianca.
My question is, my manager is retiring. He's worked for our organization for about 34 years. And we've had conversations before. He's like a Protestant pastor of sorts. And so he's actually going to continue working, doing missions and whatnot. My question is, I want to write a scripture verse in my, thank you, goodbye, farewell card, but I was hoping to put something that's Catholic based that maybe he's not familiar with that might pique his interest and also kind of get a point across that, we've got some good stuff.
Yeah, that's a great question. I think I would caveat this by saying you don't want to come off as a punk. You don't want to make it look like a gotcha moment. If, in the same way that if you were leaving and they quoted Romans 3:28, that you were justified by faith as kind of a gotcha Catholic, we would say, oh, that's so obnoxious. You're totally misunderstanding the difference in how we read that passage. And, you don't want to be obnoxious with I think you want to strike a note, emphasizing the true, the good, and the beautiful. And I think this is something that maybe as Catholics we can forget about, like, depending on a person's upbringing, they may not have ever met really biblically well-read Catholics and Catholics who are really faithful followers of Jesus Christ. Like, if you are one of those and you're in a church with a bunch of other people like that, you can take for granted, like, of course there are Catholics who love Jesus. Of course. You know, that's what we're, that's literally why we exist. It's the raison d'etre. But many people, their experience of Catholics is, you know, lukewarm, mediocre, kind of people who call themselves Catholic, but you wouldn't know they're Christian. And so given that, I think there's something to be said for just a verse that really builds up Christian unity. So I would recommend John 17, 20 to 21, which is, I do not pray for these only, but also for those who believe in me through their word, that they may all be one, even as thou, Father, art in me and I in thee, that they also may be in one, so that the world may believe that thou hast sent me. Now, that's a good call for Christian unity, which on the one hand affirms him as a brother in Christ, and on the other hand is hopefully a gentle tug without being obnoxious to the fact that we really should be one church. We shouldn't be a bunch of rival denominations competing against each other and all of that. So there's a little bit of a push there, but it's in the context of something that I hope is focused on recognizing what's true, good, and beautiful already present in his life. Does that make sense?
It sure does, and I greatly appreciate it. You understood my question perfectly.
Oh, good. Well, I'm happy to hear that.
Beautiful. Hey, Bianca, do you have a copy of Joe's book, The Early Church Was the Catholic Church?
I just got that book. Yes, I did.
Oh, well, congratulations. I just wanted to say congratulations on that. But wait a second. I wanted to give you a size book
as a consolation prize, a teacher of strange things.
Oh, that'd be awesome.
And what a consolation prize it is. It is meant to be a consoling book. It's about Jesus. So, yes, you can have it. Bianca, hang on the line. Edgar will send it to you. I'm Cy Kellett, your host. You might not recognize me because I'm super nice today because I'm in Iowa, and everyone in Iowa is nice. Joe Heschmeyer is our guest. He's in Kansas City, and you can call with any question you want about the Catholic faith, 888-318-7884. But we have a special segment of the show where Thomas joins us, and I sometimes give a name to the segment. I invent a name for the segment because we don't have a permanent name for it. And then Thomas's mother sent me an email saying that I needed to include Thomas's name in every new title I came up with for the TikTok segment. So here is Thomas the TikTok engine with a question from TikTok.
I'm glad your naming skills went back to kindergarten on that one, Si. I remember those days fondly.
That's one of the best shows ever on TV.
It absolutely
don't
is.
Even
I thought
say
he
anything
engineered
bad
a pretty good name there.
I thought he did.
Thank you, Joe.
Joe, I'm not going to come on for you
anymore.
You
and I anymore. Have the same train of thought.
Oh. I don't have any good... I lost the track there for a second. I couldn't think of any other ones.
Oh, you went off the rails a little bit. Thomas, you better ask your question.
You're making me want to cancel the segment entirely. This is getting
Thomas,
dangerous here.
Thomas, that would break my heart.
I know, Si. So, Joe,
Thomas,
before this
TikTok
goes...
TikTok engine, go ahead.
Before this gets any more out of hand, the question I brought to you today from one of our TikTok viewers just says, how do we know Jesus was here for all of us and not just the Jews, since he is the Jewish Messiah?
Yeah, it's a great question. So from the very beginning, if you go all the way back to Abraham, God is explicit in the book of Genesis that all the nations of the earth, meaning all the Gentiles as well as the Jews, would be blessed by Abraham. You get that in Genesis 18:18. You get that in Genesis 22:18. And this is really the trajectory that Israel is the chosen people, not because God says, I love this one nation and I don't care about anybody else, but because that one nation is given for the salvation of everybody else, that this one chosen people are there to spread the gospel to the whole world. And there's a lot of ways that happens. It's kind of an ongoing revelation, but the fullness of this is Jesus of Nazareth coming. And so if you go back to the Old Testament, there are all these prophecies, for instance, Isaiah 66, that point to the fact that the Messiah is going to bring in the nations, and they're going to offer true worship as well. Malachi chapter 1 talks about from the rising of the sun to the setting, the name of God will be praised throughout the world, and there'll be this true offering, this true sacrifice, which we would recognize as the sacrifice of the Mass. That the point of Jesus' coming is in no small part both to fulfill the messianic expectations of Israel and also as a light of revelation to the Gentiles. And we're told that explicitly in the Gospel of Luke in the infancy narrative, that when Simeon holds up the baby Jesus, these are the two things that he says that he's doing. And so that's how we understand Jesus's mission. Jesus puts it in terms of what he calls the sign of Jonah in Matthew 16. And what makes it so revolutionary is that Jonah was the Jewish prophet to the Gentiles. He went to the Ninevites. He went to the enemies of Israel to preach God even there. So that's what Jesus is doing. He's fulfilling the messianic expectation of Israel. He is the savior of the Jews. He's also the light of the nations. He is the savior of the Gentiles. He is the savior of the whole world.
All right. So he's the Jewish Messiah insofar as, you know, the Hebrew people were the preparation for him and that the prophecies about him were given to him. But he's the universal Messiah because those prophecies said he's going to be a light to all the Gentiles, everyone. Is that basically it?
Yeah. I mean, as Jesus says to the Samaritan woman, salvation is from the Jews. But salvation isn't confined to the Jews. So the Jews have this special role in salvation. And they're to be not only the bearers of it, but also the recipients of it. God wants every Jewish person in heaven. God also wants every Gentile person in heaven. And so this is the kind of fascinating thing that St. Paul talks about this in Romans, that there's special revelation given to the Jews, what he calls the oracles of God. They've got the Old Testament. So they have this special set of prophecy that the other nations didn't have. But they're also held to a higher standard as a result of it. But then with the coming of Christ, you see all of that playing out in the spread of this gospel to all nations. So you look at the last thing Jesus says in Matthew 28, verse 19 to 20. He says, go out and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. That he doesn't mean this to just be a message of salvation for this one little corner of the earth, but for the entire earth, for all people.
All right. Thanks a lot, Joe.
Thomas. Thank you, Thomas, the TikTok engine. Appreciate that. And I would have kept going with the puns and everything, Joe, but I think that was running out of steam, don't you think? Thomas.
Yeah, I'm glad we could get in the caboose with that.
So just to clear the air, I do think Thomas the Tank Engine was an incredible show, really formative in my ears. So I am very honored that you named the segment after that. Really appreciate that.
Thank you, Gordon. Let's go to...
wait, was that Ringo Starr? I just want to be clear. Gordon?
Yeah, Ringo Starr was Thomas. He was Starr was the narrator of it, and then George Carlin, and somebody else too. But Ringo Starr, I mean, was the best. He just was. Ringo Starr was the best. David in Peoria, Illinois, listening on the Catholic Answers Live app. David, thanks for downloading the app onto your phone. Go ahead with your question for Joe.
Thanks for having me on again, and I've been appreciating your podcast too, Joe. Great podcast. My question's on the Sacrament of Reconciliation. Any of the earliest sources that you can give for that? I'm researching it at the moment. I appreciate that.
The Sacrament of Reconciliation is really fascinating because it kind of morphs over time. Like, one of the major changes over time is that we start doing it privately instead of having you confess your sins in front of, like, the whole church. And you can imagine why this was a happy change. So when you go back to early Christianity, it doesn't look the same way that it looks now. But if we're talking about the origins of the sacrament, we find them in Scripture itself. In John 20, when Jesus breathes on the disciples, and in verse 22, he says, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." So it's very clear from Scripture itself that the apostles are given this special role of forgiving sins. We also note from James 5:16 that we're to confess our sins to one another. So there's this call for Christian confession. In other words, you're not meant to just confess your sins to God only, because every sin hurts both your relationship with God, but it also hurts the body of Christ. This is something I think we, both Catholics and Protestants, tend to not take seriously enough. St. John Paul II talks about this in a document called Reconciliation and Penance. And it's based on 1 Corinthians 12, that when one part of the body suffers, we all suffer together. So if you intentionally incur suffering through sin, you cause the entire body of Christ to suffer, even if you think of it as a private sin. And one of the ways you cause the entire body of Christ to suffer is that you're given this role to help build up the body of Christ. And when you're not living out your role, It's like if you don't do your job at work, even if no one knows that you're not doing your job, you're hurting the entire company, or, you know, that kind of idea, sort of. And so we confess our sins to one another because we've hurt our neighbor. And we combine that with John 20 about receiving the Holy Spirit and forgiving the sins. That's where you get the origins of it. Now, you'll find church fathers talking about the sacrament of penance as the second plank of salvation after the shipwreck, which is the loss of grace. And the Catechism talks about that in 1446. I believe Tertullian is the one who originates that. I may be misremembering that. It may have been Origen. It's one of the kind of controversial figures. And then you'll find later church fathers as well. So at around 200, you find some pretty explicit references to it. But yeah, it's rooted in this very biblical idea.
I, you know what? I better leave it there, too, because we are a little bit late for a break. So we'll take our break. We'll be right back with more Open Forum with Joe Heschmeyer on Catholic Answers Live.
This is Archbishop Paul Coakley, the Archdiocese of Oklahoma City, and you're listening to Catholic Answers Live.
Do you love praying for people? Have you ever wanted to use your gift of prayer to share Jesus with others and build up the body of Christ? Start a public prayer station with St. Paul Street Evangelization. Listen to people's needs, pray with them, or invite them to meet you at church. St. Paul Street Evangelization can help you get started. Find out how at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
EWTN, teaching the truth.
I'm a devout Methodist. I've went to the same church since I was a little boy, and I just feel like my church is starting to leave me. I listen to this station a lot when I'm on the tractor, when I'm working. It's comforting to just listen to this day in and day out, and every day it just draws me a little more near to it. How do I leave what my roots are for something that I know will better me in the future? It's just real hard cutting that tie.
Live. I am Cy Kelly, your host. Joe Heschmeyer, our guest. We're having a good time. Lots of great questions today. You're very welcome here. There are, let me see, I think there's a line open. I don't think my math is very good at the moment, but I think there's a line open. 888-318-7884. We'd love to have you here if you've got a question about the Catholic faith. Joe, of course, Catholic apologist, longtime Catholic apologist, and now for several years. How long? What is it, a year and a half, 2 years you've been a member of the Catholic Answers?
Yeah, a year and a half.
Three? A year and a half.
Man, March of last year.
Time. Yep. He's also the author of a whole bunch of books, including Pope Peter, which is about Pope Peter, and the early church was the Catholic Church. That one's about how the early church was the Catholic Church. And he wrote one called A Man Named Joseph, which is about a man named Joseph. 888-318-7884, the number here, 888-31-TRUTH. Shall we go to another caller, Joe?
Let's go to another caller. Although I liked your descriptions of all my books. I think you'll be in charge of introducing them from now on. You need a little blurb on the back.
I think I could come up with the titles. Like I feel like I get I see the pattern that developed there with your titling.
Exactly.
I think I could follow that pattern. Mick in Long Island, New York, one of those coastal people. We're glad you're here, Mick. Go ahead with your question for Joe.
Hey, I just want to say I've also been really enjoying your podcast, Joe. And the question I actually have is slightly related to the episode that released, I think it was today or yesterday, something like that. Anyway, point being, I wanted to ask about something I considered to be the best point that John Calvin ever makes, and that is that to a first century Jew, what Jesus and the apostles did would have looked like schism, mm-hmm. but it wasn't. How should we understand, you know, how should we really understand, like, the transition from Judaism to Christianity, and, like, how is that distinct from, like, schism, I guess?
Yeah, that's a great question. And I think you're right. This is it's a good argument from John Calvin's perspective, especially if the reformers were thinking of themselves as another Jesus, which, you know, once you spell out that part, you're like, oh, wait, actually, there's a problem there. Wait a second. Let's unpack it a little bit. So Judaism includes a messianic expectation. Like when you read the Old Testament, it's replete with these promises of a coming Messiah. You know, the end of Exodus, there's this sense that there, you know, Moses spoke to God face to face and that no one after him had done that. That there's this kind of, okay, things aren't as good as they were with Moses, but then there's the foretelling that someone even better than Moses is going to come. And so you have this promise that someone will come and gather the nations. Daniel 2 even gives us a timeline. If you look at Nebuchadnezzar's dream, there's going to be the four kingdoms. The Babylonian kingdom is first. And in the age of the fourth kingdom, a stone not formed by human hands will come and establish a kingdom that won't be eradicated. And that kingdom is the church. And so the idea that the Messiah was going to come, that he was going to start a new kingdom of God on earth, all of that is found in the Old Testament. Now, Jesus comes and does that. Now, it's worth reading, you know, in Acts, Gamaliel points out that there were several different messianic movements at the time that were, you know, these false messiahs, meaning that the Jewish people knew the Messiah was coming and even had a sense of when the Messiah was coming. You have the prophecy of weeks in Daniel. You have all these things that point to roughly the time and place in which to expect the Messiah. And so when Jesus of Nazareth comes and preaches, there's solid reason to believe that this is the fulfillment of Israel's messianic expectation. Now, there's nothing like that with the Reformation. There are no passages that say, you know, in 1500 years, the true prophet will come and restore Christianity. There's nothing like that. You know, Protestants are fond of pointing this out against Mormons, that there's no promises of restoration or some prophet after Jesus. There's no prophecy of Joseph Smith in the New Testament. Well, neither is there a prophecy of Martin Luther or John Calvin. And so the analogy to the first century only works if you think that John Calvin is the new Jesus, or that Martin Luther is the new Jesus, or at least the new Joseph Smith, who's come and rebuilt the true church after it fell away. Once you realize that that's obviously false, that's obviously heretical, then you see that there was an expectation all throughout the Old Testament that there'd be a messianic expectation, and then that kingdom would be indestructible. That's part of the Daniel 2 prophecy. And so when Jesus says the gates of hell won't overcome, he's actually not saying anything that wasn't already found in the Old Testament. And so when Luther and Calvin and others say, in short, that the gates of hell did overcome, that Christ's mountain fell down and they have to rebuild it, well, they're presenting themselves in this role that really is incompatible with the New Testament. It really is incompatible with the New or Old Testament. Like, that's where I think the major difference comes in. How does that strike you?
Yeah, I think that makes sense. There is one other sort of, it's kind of a follow-up, I guess.
Yeah, please.
And that is, before Jesus comes, you know, Jesus tells the apostles himself that, you know, listen to the authorities because they sit on the seat of Moses. Mm-hmm. But there's a 40-year period in between Jesus' life and the destruction of the temple. And in that period, were the apostles still bound to follow their authority?
It's a complicated story because, in one sense, yes. You see this actually pretty clearly in Acts. St. Paul is before the Sanhedrin. And when he talks back to the high priest, he's struck, and then he apologizes. Paul apologizes. As far as I know, this is the only time Paul apologizes, because he didn't know it was the high priest. And he quotes scripture that you shouldn't speak against the ruler of the people. However, there's a limit on this. And so you also see when Peter and John are before the Sanhedrin that they're very clear that we must obey God rather than men. And so inasmuch as the Sanhedrin is speaking against Christian revelation, then they weren't to be followed. Inasmuch as they were still the rulers of the people, then they should be followed. And we're under a similar sort of authority in terms of secular leadership now, that inasmuch as the legitimate government passes a law, you should follow it. You shouldn't encourage, you know, needless rebellion, revolution, tumult, and all that. But inasmuch as the state goes against God, then you actually have a duty to obey God rather than men. So it is a somewhat complicated picture in that sense, while there is still this temple authority, where you have a dual kind of leadership between the Sanhedrin, but then also the Roman government. And that ends in 70. So you can also see this in relatedly. Peter and John are in the temple in the time of prayer in the book of Acts. So they continue to go to the temple to pray. they continue to recognize this role the temple has, even as a religious center, because nothing in the temple was contrary to Christianity. It's just that what is done in the temple has been fulfilled in Christ, not repudiated by Christ.
And I'm going to leave that there. I hope that that was helpful to you, Mick. But I've got another question we can get to, I think, before the hour ends. Craig in Temecula, California, listening on the EWTN app. If you can be somewhat prompt with your question, Craig, I'm sure that Joe can get you an answer.
Yeah, thank you for taking my call. My question is, I have a really good friend. He's Catholic. And over the last couple of years, he's been talking to a medium. And she has told him stuff about family members, things in his life. She's communicated with him. And he told me that she mentioned stuff that only he would know. So I told him that he knows I listen to Catholic radio a lot. So I thought I'd call in and see if I could get some help on which direction I should take him. I did tell him to go see a priest. And unfortunately, the priest that he saw said that as long as it was positive things, it was okay. And to you guys, it's not okay. So a little bit of help would be appreciated.
Well, first of all, I think you should make a note to the priest bishop, because that is awful advice. The catechism is very explicit. I'm going to give you a catechism paragraph 2116, which says all forms of divination are to be rejected, recourse to Satan or demons, conjuring up the dead, or other practices falsely supposed to unveil the future. Also mentions horoscopes, astrology, palm reading, interpretation of the omens and lots. But it also explicitly mentions recourse to mediums. So this was forbidden in the Old Testament. You may remember the Witch of Endor, when Saul goes to a medium and tries to conjure up Samuel. But you also have it explicitly condemned by the Catholic Church in paragraph 2116 of the Catechism. This is absolutely and utterly forbidden, because what you're dealing with there are you're opening really dangerous pathways to the enemy, to dark spiritual forces. Now, the devil may tell you something true as a way of enticing you to kind of remain in communion with him, but that is not a doorway you want to open. And he may also tell you, by the way, false things by pretending to be a dead relative. So don't play around with that. If you want to pray to holy dead relatives, you can do that. You cannot go to a medium. You cannot conjure up the dead. And don't try to do any of that stuff where you're going around God, where you're trying to take those spiritual powers into your own hands. That is not your place, and that is a really dangerous game to play.
Is that clear enough for you?
Awesome. Thank you so much. Very clear.
Yeah,
thank
you bet.
Guys.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Craig. That is kind of a shocking answer from that priest, Joe. I feel like I heard the sense of shock in your voice.
I'm quite stunned. It's like, what are you doing if you don't know which team you play for?
Well, you know, I kind of feel that way about people who are Catholic will tell me about these mediums on television. I think one of whom claims to be Catholic, and it really is quite startling, because this is something that's really out of bounds. You should not be, as you said, conjuring the dead. Have you seen any of these television mediums, Joe? Have you seen?
I know of them, and I think a lot of them are charlatans. But I think a lot of to go to a medium, you have to believe two things. One, the spiritual realm is real, because otherwise you wouldn't waste your time. But two, you can ignore everything the Catholic Church says about the spiritual realm, because otherwise you wouldn't go to these. And I don't understand how you can believe those two things. Like, if you take the spiritual battle seriously, don't let the enemy into your tents.
Amen, brother. Joe Heschmeyer is our guest, and you are welcome to call if you have questions about the Catholic faith, Catholic teaching, Catholic doctrine, the Bible, Jesus, God, any of it, whether you're Catholic or not. 888-318-7884. If you're on the line, hang on the line, because we're not going to be gone very long. We will be right back after just a couple messages. And if you haven't dialed yet, go ahead and dial, because we'd love to take your call. 888-318-7884. Joe Heschmeyer, more calls for him. Open forum after this on Catholic Answers Live. Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Kellett, your host. Joe Heschmeyer is our guest. And we continue with open forum this hour. If you've got a question, we'd love to hear it. 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884. If you happen to be watching on the video and you see behind me that beautiful sign that says Iowa Catholic Radio Network, that's because I am in Des Moines, Iowa, tomorrow night doing their December Days fundraiser. And today got to do a nice talk with a wonderful group of men and a few women at St. Augustine Church here. Talked about Joan of Arc, and I am always fired up when I talk about Joan of Arc, so that was a lot of fun. And it's just great to get to come visit the Midwest from California. It's a beautiful time of year to be here. You know, we don't get all this nice, cool weather and all that. And also to see what normal people pay for a gallon of gas. It's been amazing. I mean, I saw a price that was more than $2 cheaper than the cheapest price I have seen in California all year. More than $2 cheaper. And it was at like 10 gas stations. It wasn't like just one person went crazy. It was at a bunch of gas stations. So now that I know what's going on here in the Midwest, I will possibly be moving here. Joe Heschmeyer, our guest, is a Midwesterner down in Kansas City. Welcome back, Joe. Thanks for coming back.
It's my pleasure. I was going to say you should bring some gas back with you, but that's actually a federal crime, I think. You'd be going on an airplane.
I could maybe get a thermos.
I cannot recommend
but
you do
nah,
that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What? I could be. What? I didn't know. There's no sign here that says no gasoline. Yeah. No, I, it's, Joe, it's less than half the price here in Des Moines that it is in California. That makes me think we might be doing something wrong in California. I mean, I love my state, but it does make me question whether we're doing everything right. Maybe perhaps we made some mistakes.
It's actually something that's really nice, because when I go out to California, I feel this incredible weather, and there's great food, and people are really friendly. And every time I start to get a little swept away, I see a gas station and think, oh, right, that's why I live here.
Right. Oh, they do have awfully good enchiladas, but look at that gas price. Yeah,
right.
Well, yeah, I guess there's trade-offs. Yeah. And that's nice that you come to California and think that the people are really nice, though, because I think in San Diego, people are very nice. I joke
yeah, you
about
know,
it.
And I will say I this on behalf nice of California. City. You've been very nice to the Midwest here. I will say in California's defense that the rest of the country's stereotype of California is really just like San Francisco and part of L.A. And that the rest of the state, there's a lot of good parts.
Although I do think there are other stereotypes of California that some of how shall I categorize these people? Some of people that you might be familiar with as real housewives have generated other stereotypes about California, and that you will find in Orange County and some other areas. But I love my state. I mean, I think people know that I'm joking around a little bit about California, but I don't know. But I do have some feelings. I've developed feelings about the gas prices now. I didn't have feelings about it before, but now I have feelings about it. The number is 888-318-7884. Joe Heschmeyer is our guest. You're welcome to call. Jack from Australia called, and he's on the line. And if you call from Australia, call from tomorrow morning. We got to get right to you. Jack, thanks for the call. Go ahead with your question for Joe.
G'day, g'day. How are you both going?
We're going well. How are you going,
no
Joe?
One,
wait,
no
I just
one
want to say
as well.
I
I'm
going
to say howdy in second place to that.
Go through so many numbers.
Oh, how many numbers did you have to dial to get to us from Australia? Like,
so you have your number, but then because there's so many different options to be able to call, you either have to add the plus or the 0011, and then there's different options.
Oh,
and
yeah.
I went through about 20 numbers trying to get through to you. It's insane. But, yeah.
I'm sorry, real quick.
We appreciate that you did it.
When I was 16, I was in the United Kingdom for the first time, and I had a calling card to call back home because that was still a thing you needed then. But I didn't know
was it an MCI calling card?
Yeah, totally. And you have to do the either plus one or 001. And I didn't know how to do that. So it was like several days before I confirmed with my parents that I actually had made it to the country safely.
You were alive.
Which I think was a little alarming. So.
Well, I don't know if Jack realized that how much he delights us when he says, how you going? because that is not an American phrase. That is an Australian
phrase.
Good
day,
good and it day. Is so it's so much better than what we say in America. Like, how are you going? Why do Americans say, how's it going? Who cares how's it going? How are you going? That's a nice question.
Yeah, it's
so anyways,
personal. Jack. It's true. Beautiful.
Yeah. Well, I'm glad to hear it. My question has related to something in Scripture. So a popular Islamic scholar/preacher claims that the Quran is the infallible, perfect word of God and has no contradictions. And then he goes on to say, so if I can find a contradiction in the Bible, it must not be from God. And then he goes on to quote two passages from Scripture, Matthew 27:5, which says... that he fell and burst open after throwing the coins in the temple, and then Acts 1:18, Matthew 27:5 is where he threw the coins and then hung himself, and then Acts 1:18 is where he bought the land and fell over headlong, bursting open, I believe. But how can we answer this and defend our faith in light of these passages, which they claim is a clear contradiction?
Years ago, I watched a scene in, I think, the movie's Hannibal. Now, this is not an endorsement of the movie at all. This was years ago. I don't think I would watch it today. I'm sure there's stuff in there I would cringe if you went back and saw it and said, oh, a Catholic answer's apologist told me to watch this. But what it did do for me was it revealed how these two things can both be true. Because in that scene, a person partially disembowels themselves and then hangs themselves, causing their guts to fall forth. It's really gross. It's a disgusting scene. But it shows exactly what's being described in both Acts 1:18 and in Matthew 27, that Judas probably cut himself in the guts, and then when he throws his body down by hanging himself, his insides become his outsides. So there's no contradiction there. They're describing two aspects of the same death. This is one of those things where it's an obvious enough spot that you would think if there was a contradiction there, that the early Christians would have said, wait a second, one of these has to be right, one of them has to be wrong. But rather, they were understood as just describing the death in two different ways. They were describing two different aspects of it. And these are also, by the way, the two places that mention the purchasing of the potter's field. So it isn't like they're unaware of the tradition of Judas's death, because they both refer to this specific detail with it. So I don't think there's a contradiction there. I think they're just describing different parts. We could say there's much more that could be said about, the contradiction in Islam, even in the way it approaches the gospel, the notion of the Injil, the gospel allegedly written by Jesus that no one's ever found. It doesn't, the Islamic testimony may be internally coherent, but it doesn't match up with history. It doesn't match up with anything we know outside of the Quran. So, yeah, that's, I guess, what I would say to that.
Yeah, well, I mean, I don't think there's a contradiction, because I believe it is God's word. But I don't know how to respond to that. So, I mean, while you're not endorsing watching it, I will probably give that scene I'll give it a quick glance over, just so I could get the idea, so I could formulate a defense. But thank you very much for taking my question.
Yeah, you bet.
Thank you, Jack. Thanks very much. That brings us just about to the break, so we'll get ready to take a break. But if you are Muslim, I do encourage read those Gospels. And if you find those contradictions or things that appear to be contradictions, we'd love to talk with you about them. But more than anything, read those Gospels. It's not going to hurt. You won't be sorry you did. And we'd be happy to answer any questions that come up. Let's take a quick break. Be right back with Joe Heschmeyer and more Open Forum on Catholic Answers Live.
Miss a show? Make sure to catch up by downloading the podcast, available online at Catholic.com.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects homebuyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
The destination for great Catholic audio programming is EWTN Podcast Central, featuring the best of EWTN radio, as well as faith-filled podcasts from our friends and affiliates across the nation, all in one place, all free. If it's central to the faith, you can find it on EWTN Podcast Central. It's like podcast heaven. Visit EWTN.com/radio/podcasts today.
Welcome back. Catholic Answers Live. Thanks so much for being here with us. Joe Heschmeyer is our guest, and I did it again. I have pretty much every day since Advent started, I have waited until late in the show to wish you a blessed Advent. It really should be among the first things that I say because, I mean, when we're celebrating an important liturgical season of the church, I do want to acknowledge it. But I don't know what's up with me this year. But
you know what? It's a season of waiting, so it's fitting that people should have to wait for the greeting.
Joe finds the silver. That's right, Joe. It's a theological lesson I was trying to impart by making people wait. Right? It wasn't that I was just messing up. I appreciate that, Joe. Joe Heschmeyer, by the way, we mentioned it last time. Yeah, that he'll get around to it. Last hour I mentioned it, but maybe you're just joining us this hour. Joe's got a new podcast, and really, I'm not blowing smoke here. It's getting rave reviews. People love it. And we've had people send texts and emails. We've had people call the show and say how much they're enjoying Joe's new podcast. It's called Shameless Popery. It's just like his blog that he used to do. But now it's got audio, it's got video, and it's got Joe passionately sharing and defending the faith. Shameless Popery is the name, but the place you can go to get it is shamelessjoe.com. I think they wanted to make it as easy as they could on you. Shamelessjoe.com. Go there and check it out. Right, Joe?
You can also get it wherever you normally get podcasts if you just type in Shameless Popery. But in case you don't know how to spell popery, P-O-P-E-R-Y, you can also go to shamelessjoe.com, whichever is easier.
It's easier to spell Joe than popery. Even if you're really Catholic, it's easier to spell Joe than popery. Jim in Missouri Jim in Missouri is next. Listen to EWTN on Channel 130, Sirius XM Satellite Radio. Jim, always happy to talk with a fellow Midwesterner. Go ahead with your question for Joe.
That's right, and from Camdenton. So, Joe, I'm glad you enjoyed my neighbor's hospitality this weekend.
Oh, it was a wonderful time in Camdenton. I was very impressed.
Yeah, good. So I'll get to my question. In Genesis, Adam gets a mate. The Lord believes that Adam was lonely and needed a mate, made a woman. So later on in the Bible, Paul, the avowed bachelor, apparently, in his letter to the Corinthians, kind of puts down marriage in my mind. He says, hey, don't get married unless you can't help yourself. And it's best if you don't get married. So how do you reconcile that? It seems like the Lord thinks things are better if a man is married, has a companion, yet Paul says that he doesn't really think so, that it's best to remain solo.
Yeah, that's a great question. And I'm glad you hit on those passages. I think there's a passage that's going to harmonize those and show how they fit together. But I'd say if you want the long answer for this, Pope John Paul II's Theology of the Body, his whole series of lectures that he gives, he begins with this idea of original solitude, which is all about it is not good for man to be alone. And then he continues over the course of a couple of years doing these Wednesday audiences where he then unpacks the meaning of the body, human relationality, but then how do celibacy and virginity fit into that? So if you want the much longer, much more technical answer, you could read John Paul II. You could also read, you know, any of the Wolfstein, Christopher West, any of the people who've tried to summarize what JP2 is saying. But nevertheless, I think we can give a simple kind of brief answer, which is that in Matthew 19, Jesus shows both of these truths. Because the Pharisees come up and ask Jesus about divorce and about remarriage. And Jesus begins in verse 4. Have you not read that he who made them from the beginning made them male and female? And then he quotes the passage about the two becoming one flesh in Genesis. That's all about this original solitude, that it is good to be married. But then the disciples, realizing how radical the Christian teaching on marriage is, that you cannot get divorced and remarried, say, if such is the case for a man and his wife, it is not expedient to marry. And then in verse 11, Jesus doesn't disagree with them. He says, not all men can receive this precept, but only those to whom it is given. For there are eunuchs who have been made so from birth, and there are eunuchs who have been made eunuchs by men, and there are eunuchs who have made themselves eunuchs for the sake of the kingdom of heaven. He who is able to receive this, let him receive it. So Jesus gives a very clear trifold structure that divorce and remarriage is sinful. We could say fornication is sinful. All of that is sinful. That's the bad category. Marriage is the good category. It's God-given, We say Jesus raises marriage to the dignity of a sacrament. And St. Paul says the same thing. It is better to marry than to burn. He has a clear distinction between marriage is definitely better than living a sinful single life or involuntary kind of celibacy. Marriage is better than that. But both Jesus and St. Paul are also clear that there is this other thing you can do, this voluntary renunciation for the kingdom that's actually even higher. So how do we harmonize that with the original teaching that it is not good for man to be alone? Well, the idea is that a voluntary sacrifice has to be a sacrifice of something good. That only if you understand marriage as a God-given good can you sacrifice it for an even higher good. So think about Lent. In Lent, you give up something that's like a good thing you've gotten from God. Your Lenten penance cannot just be, I'm not going to commit this mortal sin that I ordinarily commit. Like, that's not a sacrifice. That's the bare minimum of what you're already called to as a Christian. That sacrifice in the Christian sense is offering something more to God. And so and you're giving up something good. So think about the difference between starvation and fasting. With starvation, you don't have any food and that's bad. With fasting, you voluntarily deprive yourself of the good of food for a higher spiritual good. And that's good. So fasting and starvation might look the same, but spiritually, they're a world apart. Likewise, involuntary celibacy and voluntary celibacy might look the same, but spiritually, they're a world apart. How does that strike you?
I can understand that. That makes sense to me. One question further on that would be, is there a possibility also that Paul was speaking to a certain audience, maybe people destined to be priests, something like that, or was his audience there just a general population?
Well, his audience is a general population, but his advice isn't for everyone. He's very clear that those who can receive it should receive it. And Jesus says the same thing, that not everyone is called to celibacy or virginity. And so, you know, Paul is very clear, if you're going to burn, if you're going to be like consumed with lust, if you try to be a celibate, then don't pursue this route. That's not good for you spiritually. And the church follows this wisdom. You know, so for instance, if someone becomes a priest and they realize part of the way through their priesthood that they cannot live out celibacy without constantly being in mortal sin, well, then the church will say, we're going to release you from these promises you made because it's better to marry than to burn. So you have things like voluntary laicization that happens in those cases. So, yeah, the one who can make that sacrifice, the one who's called to that sacrifice, that is a very good sacrifice to make. Because anytime you give up something good for God in pursuit of something better, that's something that we want to encourage. That's not just true for priests. That's true for everybody. You know, the spiritual life, you're to be a pilgrim on this earth. You're not to get overly attached to the things of earth, whether that's family, whether that's material comforts, whether that's fill in the blank, that you should always be ready to give up everything you have for the sake of the kingdom of God. And if you're not ready to do that, you haven't fully embraced the high cost of discipleship.
Yeah, I get that. All right. Well, thanks, guys.
Yeah, you
thanks,
bet.
Jim. Thanks very, very much. Joe Heschmeyer, our guest. It's Open Forum. And we go right here to Iowa. Ralph in Iowa, listening on 105.3 FM. Ralph, we're both in Iowa.
Yes. And as far as your comment goes about Iowans, that's true. But I've heard that people from Kansas are even better.
Hey, well, look at that. That's
you,
a very
Ralph.
Kind comment.
Well, wait a second. Okay. If a guy from Iowa says that people... Go ahead, Ralph.
Okay. My question was about, because somebody else asked this, why did Jesus come when he came? Now, you inferred some stuff with another guy earlier, but I was told by somebody else about the historical part of it, because the Romans were developing so many roads and all this kind of stuff, and it made it advantageous that they could travel and spread the word of God much easier and things like that. So I and if you give biblical contents, same sort of slow, because I got to jot them down for my RCIA class. All right.
Okay. Great. Well, let me start by saying that this is a great question that St. Thomas Aquinas answers in the Summa. And this is part three of the Summa. It is question one of part three, article five. So if you want a much more thorough answer, you can find it there. And what Aquinas is trying to do is he answers two things. Well, shouldn't God have come? Shouldn't the incarnation have happened right when Adam and Eve fell? And then in Article 6, he says, well, shouldn't he have come at the very end of the world? You know, because you can think those would be two obvious kind of counter candidates. Now, you could make a similar suggestion at any other point. But he responds to these kind of arguments by pointing out the evidence from Scripture itself. In Galatians 4:4, St. Paul says that when the fullness of time was come, God sent his son, born of a woman, born under the law. That we know from Scripture that the timing was just right. And so Aquinas suggests several reasons for this. Now, we should be clear that some of this is speculative, right? But one of the things that he points out is that there's a kind of spiritual path that people had to kind of see the severity of sin before they were even ready to kind of recognize their need for a Savior. And that certainly, I think, one important part of the answer. I think the thing you said about the Roman roads is another important part of the answer. Paul says he didn't want to wait too long lest the fervor of faith should cool by the length of time. That if you delay the incarnation too much, okay, well, then you've got a problem that, you know, people will despair. If you have the incarnation before you have written records or before you have, you know, modern means of communication, then you have the incarnation, it doesn't spread, or there's no good historical record for it. So you can see the wisdom and the beauty and the brilliance of Jesus coming right when he came. And one of the ways we know that there's this wisdom, brilliance, and beauty to it is that Christianity took off, meaning that simply as a matter of history, we know two things. There have been numerous messianic movements within Judaism. Within Hasidic Judaism, even today, there are people who claim to be the Messiah. And yet, none of those have transformed the world in the way Christianity has. That Jesus came at such a time in such a place that the world was ready for him, and the Christian message very quickly spread all over the world. And so I'd say, given that, we can point to a very kind of complicated amalgam of factors. One of them is that with the spread of the Roman Empire, Greek and Latin were languages that a great number of nations spoke, which made it very easy to quickly spread the gospel, and then you could go to those places that didn't speak Greek and Latin. So there's all sorts of historical factors that kind of factor into that, but Jesus doesn't want to do it too soon and have it be lost to history, or have people not appreciate the gravity of sin. He doesn't want to do it too late and have us just be overwhelmed with despair for our sins. So there's spiritual as well as really pragmatic reasons that I would point to there.
Ralph, what do you think?
I like that. And that was the Summa Part 3, Question 1, Article 5.
Question 1. Yeah, really Article 5 and Article 6, but mostly Article 5. So yeah, Article 5 and 6 go together.
Very good. Thank you very, very much.
Yeah, you bet.
Thank you, Ralph, my fellow Iowan. 888-318-7884, the number here. And we're going to Massachusetts now. Julian in Massachusetts listening on the app. Julian, thanks for downloading the Catholic Answers app onto your phone. Go ahead with your question for Joe.
Hey, guys. Thanks for taking my call. So my question's on the death penalty. So I've heard conflicting things. I just wanted to confirm, did the church officially change teachings on the death penalty, and is it now inadmissible? And then I have a follow-up
question.
That's
a really good question. So the relevant paragraph in the Catechism is 2267, which talks about the inadmissibility of the death penalty today. And it deals with it being an attack on the inviolability and the dignity of the person, but also deals with the fact that there's a new understanding of penal sanctions and that more effective systems of detention have been developed. In other words, that the church is not just making a statement that the death penalty is always and everywhere wrong, but is rather saying the situation has changed. There may be times and places in which the death penalty was necessary. It is the church's opinion, certainly as Pope Francis has expressed, that this is no longer the case, that you can sentence someone in such a way that you neutralize the threat of them without recourse to the death penalty. Now, I think there can be a complicated question about how effectively those alternatives work, and that would be a good push to create better alternatives to the death penalty, to have more effective incarceration, maybe don't trade like arms dealers for soccer players or basketball players, or whatever it is, that there are ways you can reduce and even eliminate the risk. But that's a much more nuanced conversation than just death penalty or no.
And Julian had a follow-up question. So, Julian, if you can hang on through this break, we will allow you to get that follow-up question out. We'll get an answer from Joe. We'll take this break and be right back with more Open Forum on Catholic Answers Live.
Catholic Answers Live.
The recent decision by the U.S. Supreme Court to overturn Roe v. Wade was a monumental victory for the pro-life movement. But the fight is far from over. With our new booklet, Why We're Pro-Life, we have produced the perfect tool to prepare you to have peaceful and convincing conversations to shed light on the truth about human life from conception to natural death. Catholic Answers is printing millions of copies of this booklet, and we plan simply to give them away. You can help us in two ways. First, by generously supporting this project. 25 cents prints one book. $2,500 prints 10,000, and so on. Second, by helping us distribute the booklet through your parish, your school, or the pro-life ministry you work with. Catholic Answers is going to blanket the country with Why We're Pro-Life, but only if you step up and help us. Thank you so much. For more information, visit whyweareprolife.com.
Have you enrolled in the Catholic Answers School of Apologetics? Let me ask you a more important question. Do you believe as a Catholic that you have an obligation to share the Catholic faith? In fact, the Church has answered this question, and the answer is that all confirmed Catholics are obliged to share the faith. It's actually in canon law. Catholic Answers is here to help you fulfill that obligation. Our School of Apologetics courses will equip you to help all the people you come in contact with understand what the Church teaches and why. A great place to start is with all the Catholics in your life. Learn the art of apologetics from the best of the best and start sharing the gospel today. Visit schoolofapologetics.com. That's schoolofapologetics.com.
Miss a show? Make sure to catch up by downloading the podcast, available online at catholic.com.
This is Dr. David Anders. Join us for an engaging hour of questions and answers about the Catholic faith here on Called to Communion, Monday at 2 p.m. Eastern. Now, back to Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Kellett, your host. Joe Heschmeyer is our guest, and it's a little bit of Friday open forum. And Julian's in Massachusetts, had a question about the death penalty, but said he wanted a follow-up. And so, Julian, now is your opportunity. Go ahead with your follow-up for Joe.
Hey, can you guys hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, okay. So if that's the teaching of the Catholic Church, it still seems like the Pope's individual belief is that it's inadmissible in all cases, and that he seems to like speak out against past teachings. So if that is the case, how can the Pope like not profess and believe all that the Catholic Church believes and proclaims to be revealed by God?
Yeah, that's a really good question. And I think what the Pope has said, certainly in terms of what's in the catechism, is that, you know, in light of these very particular things, including these kind of changing circumstances, in which case he's making a prudential assessment of the times. I don't know if that makes sense, but so for instance, as Catholics, we believe that workers deserve just wages. This is something that is very clearly taught in the New Testament. But what a just wage looks like is going to differ based on culture and time and everything else. That doesn't mean that any answer is acceptable. Someone who says, I'm going to give workers a penny, I'm going to have sweatshop labor. Well, no, that's clearly outside the bounds. But there is a realm of acceptable opinion. And so what the Pope is saying is that today, in his view, the death penalty is no longer necessary, and that this is the stance of the Catholic Church. It doesn't follow from that the death penalty was always unnecessary, and it's very clear from several other popes that the death penalty was permissible. Pope John Paul II was very explicit about this. Pius XII was very explicit about this. And I think these positions can coherently, you can hold both of them. Now, having said all that, if the question is, you know, privately, will a pope always agree with everything that the church has always taught? That's not something the Catholic Church teaches. In the past, popes have dissented from things that the church has taught, or at least things that are implicitly taught by the church. There's one very famous example, Pope John the 22nd, who thought that when the souls of the just died, that they didn't enjoy the beatific vision until the second coming. And he was corrected by that, by the theologians of the University of Paris, and he recanted on that. This was not official church teaching. This was a pope's private opinion being mistaken. So it is possible for a private opinion of a pope to be mistaken. But I think in this case, there's no reason to pit Pope Francis against his predecessors, even though there's an apparent contradiction. When you read the stuff about the changing times and circumstances, to put it very plainly, if you're living in the Bronze Age and you've got like a mass murderer, you don't have like a complicated penal system, and your choices are basically put the guy to death or let him go, well, you put him to death. But today, when you actually have secure ways that you can incarcerate someone and prevent them from committing more violence, that's no longer the choice that you're faced with. Does that give any clarity to the question?
Yeah, definitely. That helps a lot. Thank you. I appreciate it.
Yeah, you bet.
God bless you, Julian. Thanks. Thanks very much for the call and for the questions. I'm going to go to Colorado now. Janine in Colorado, listening to EWTN on Channel 130, Sirius XM Satellite Radio. Janine, thank you for the call. Go ahead with your question for Joe.
No, thank you. Thank you for taking my call. So I have a question. I go to a healing service, which is anointing of the holy oil. And after everybody's done, the priest says like three different times, just remember you do not have to go to confession. Your sins have been forgiven. I just wondered what your thoughts were on that.
I'm slightly aghast by that, and I would want to know a lot more, but what I'm hearing is alarming and incorrect. So there is what's called general absolution, which under particular circumstances for a legitimate reason, where physical or moral
like
impossibility. Well, no, like, so for instance, before the Battle of Gettysburg, the Catholic chaplain there offered a general absolution so that if those soldiers who might die in battle, who hadn't had a chance to individually go to confession, they weren't going to go to hell just because they didn't have time to form a line in the middle of the battle. That's general absolution. Now, that the Vatican, or excuse me, Pope Paul VI actually has a decree on the rite of penance from 1973, which talks about this being a very special kind of exceptional circumstance that you use this. And this was abused by Catholic priests in America as well as other places, and they would just kind of willy-nilly try to give out general absolution. I don't know if that's what this priest is doing or if he's just doing some non-absolution that he thinks is as good as sacramental confession. But either way, I would A, ignore that advice, and B, say something to his superior to maybe provide some more clarity on the issue, because he could be doing really serious spiritual damage to people if he's telling them not to go to confession. The Catholic Church is very clear that regular confession is to be encouraged, even among those who aren't in mortal sin. There's a real spiritual benefit to regularly going to confession, even if you're only confessing venial sins, because it is not just about eliminating mortal sin. It also fortifies your soul and strengthens you on the journey.
Joe, okay. May I ask before,
yeah,
I'll go back to you, Janine.
Janine,
I'll go right back to you. I just want to ask Joe one question, and then I'll let you follow up. Is there another possibility that the priest is intending to administer the sacrament of the sick and is saying you don't have to go to confession because you've received forgiveness? Like,
It's possible, but even I would not like go to confession and maybe talk to the bishop because this is one of those things where I don't know enough about what's going on and what the rite is that's being used. But it sounds like either extreme unction or general anointing, or excuse me, general absolution is being abused in some way. That's not the way the church intends the sacraments to be administered.
Okay, Janine, go
ahead. Yeah, I mean, that's why I'm questioning it, because, I mean, I go every week or at least once a month. But, yes, and it just kind of confused me because a couple of the elderly people were very concerned about that statement. Mm-hmm. So I just wanted to ask. Thank you. I appreciate your input on that.
Thank you, Janine. Thanks very much. Yeah, that's a very odd situation, but we do come up against those odd situations, and it's hard to know what the priest has in mind.
I mean, my general advice is if you're doing something no other parish or no other priest is doing, that's probably a red flag. If no one else has heard of the thing you're doing, that's probably not the thing you're supposed to be doing.
Yeah, right. I'd kind of like, Janine, I maybe you could call us back and tell us how this one works out, because I'm kind of curious about what that priest thinks that he's doing. What is he up to? Merla is next, however, and I'm going to go to Merla in Las Vegas, Nevada, listening to EWTN on Channel 130, Sirius XM Satellite Radio. Merla, go ahead with your question for Joe.
Hi, good afternoon.
Hi.
Hi, Merla. We're glad you're here.
Hi. Yeah, I just want to ask because we heard and we read about a lot, like, you know, during the Mass, the Lord's Prayer, that it should be for the priest alone. And we feel like, you know, we don't do that one anymore because we read that one. But then why is not being taught in the church?
Sorry, why is what not being taught?
The Lord's Prayer that is only for the priest to raise the hands.
Oh, the raising of the hands. Not, the raising of the hands in the Lord's Prayer.
Yeah. But then it's not being taught in the church, and the priest didn't say anything about it. I kind of like having discussion with some of, fellow Catholics also. And then they said, because when I saw something that's really good to share from the EWTN, usually that I have, and I share that one in my feed, and some, having a reply on that and said, oh, no, the priest didn't say anything. It should be coming from the priest, something like that. I said, this is already, been open to, everyone, that it's only for the priest, but then we still see that one a lot in the church.
Right.
And one said also, it's not official because it's not being it's not coming really. I don't know. That's why sometimes.
Yeah, I can give a little bit of background to that, I think. It's a good question because in the general instruction of the Roman Missal, the priest is instructed to make what's called the orans position, which is the lifting up of the hands in prayer, representing his prayer on behalf of the people. And because in the liturgical context, that is the priest's kind of role. He is interceding on our behalf. He is offering his prayers on behalf of the whole church, that it is an appropriate gesture for him to make. And there's no instruction for the laity to make that gesture. And it's not really clear what it would mean for us to make that gesture in that context. Now, in other contexts, 1 Timothy 2, verse 8, St. Paul says, I desire then that in every place men should pray, lifting up holy hands without anger or argument. That there is that sense in which praying with your hands up is fine in private prayer. It's good in private prayer. That gesture of prayer is actually really good. So the general instruction neither permits nor forbids it. Now, that doesn't necessarily settle the issue. There's nothing in the instruction that says that when the priest gives the homily, you shouldn't also give a homily. But the understanding is that, the priest is supposed to be doing that. You're not supposed to be doing that. So the fact that it's not written in there not to do that, the default assumption is, no, it's meant for him to do it because of his particular priestly role. And that if you're trying to suggest that you're a priest in the same way the priest is, that's theologically confused. if you're trying to lift up your hands in worship, there's a biblical basis for it, but I would suggest in this context, it's more disruptive than it is helpful. So I don't do it. I don't get overly worked up when somebody else does it, as long as they're not trying to be the priest. There's sometimes, you know, I don't want to assume the worst of someone who does do it. This was one of those things that, you know, the laity tried to imitate what the priest is doing. There's the East and the West do the sign of the cross in opposite directions. And one of the theories behind that is that the laity imitated what they saw the priest doing, but in mirror image. And so, you know, it would not be the first time that lay people imitated the priest's gesture. But in this context, we're not called to do that. And I would suggest that it's better to keep your hands folded in prayer to signify your role as distinct from the role of the priest.
Myrtle, thanks. Okay. Thanks very, very much. The thing is, this is just one of those things, Joe, where I do think people get all kinds of different answers on that. I do appreciate your clarity. I'm not saying you weren't clear, but it's just one of those areas of church life that where people get all kinds of different answers.
I see false answers in both directions. I see it that it's been forbidden by the church, which isn't true. And I also hear people who think that the church is like calling them to do it, which also isn't true. This is, you know, neither of those is what the church has said.
But I do think your liturgical innovation where we give our own homilies while the priest is giving his is a good one. And so I'm going to go with that, Joe. So thank you for coming up with that idea. We'll take a quick break. I'm going to work
really
on my homily.
Everything.
Right back. Joe Heschmeyer, Open Forum, Catholic Answers Live.
There's only one, Catholic Answers Live.
We have a big problem. Our culture is dying, and souls are in danger of being lost. The answer is conversion to Jesus Christ in His church. St. Paul Street Evangelization is a Catholic organization, and we have hundreds of teams spreading the good news throughout the country. But we need your help. The harvest is great, but the laborers are few. Find out more and get involved today at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
Divine Intimacy Radio.
The greatest joy in my life is helping others to come to know Christ more fully. And there's no better light on this path, the path to deep union with God, than the wisdom of the saints. Talking about this daily on EWTN Radio is one of the great joys of my life.
Divine Intimacy Radio, Sunday, 6:30 a.m., 1:30 p.m., and 11 p.m. Eastern on EWTN Radio.
Catholic Answers Live. There were lots and lots of people online, but I think there's a couple lines open now that and we'll probably be able to get to you if you're the first two or three people that calls right now. Don't worry, Eric, I'm coming to you, and Lewis, I'm coming to you, but just want to let people know there's a few lines open. 888-318-7884 is the number, and it's open forum. That means open to anybody. If you're just catching the show and you're like, what, these Catholics? I don't know. I've always wanted to ask. Go ahead. You can ask. Joe would be happy to take your question and give it the best answer he can. 888-318-7884. I am informed that Luis is Luis, it says, Spanish pronunciation. So, Luis, I apologize for that. But we are coming to you, so hang on the line. Eric in Wisconsin, or Eric, maybe, in Wisconsin, watching on YouTube. You are next. Go ahead with your question.
It is originally, pronounced Eric, not Eric.
Oh, okay. Oh, yeah. Well, there we go. All right. I'm not so good with the Scandinavian names. What do I know?
Eric the misread.
Oh, my gosh.
But my question is, if God didn't want evil, why did He create the tree of the knowledge of good and evil? Because that created sin, and also, it also created evil.
That's a great question. The Catechism actually gives, a pretty clear answer to this in paragraph 396, which is that God created man in His image and established him in His friendship. A spiritual creature, man can live this friendship only in free submission to God. So you you have to understand that the way that we are created is to freely know, love, and serve God. That there is, in this realm, a twofold possibility. One, that we can choose not to submit to God. But two, related to that, it's actually impossible for us to find happiness or satisfaction apart from God. And so the Catechism in 396 goes on to say, the prohibition against eating of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil spells this out. For in the day you eat of it, you shall die. The tree of the knowledge of good and evil symbolically evokes the insurmountable limits that man, being a creature, must freely recognize and respect with trust. Man is dependent on his creator and subject to the laws of creation and to the moral norms that govern the use of freedom. Let me break that down. That God creates us as rational creatures. We're able to have we have an intellect and a will. We're able to think about things. We're able to rationalize. We're able to do all sorts of things animals can't do. But we're rational creatures. So we're both creatures and we're rational. Inherent within that is twofold fact. One, because we're creatures, we cannot provide our own glorification. We cannot provide our own satisfaction. We aren't the solution to our own quest for happiness. Because we're rational, we can know that, and we can also choose to go a different route. If we weren't rational, we would just naturally follow our nature. That was a very bad sentence, but you get the idea. We'd just follow our nature, our instincts, whatever. Water flowing downhill doesn't think, you know, maybe it should flow somewhere else. It's always going to take the path of least resistance. Same thing with electricity. Animals are always going to follow their instincts. As rational creatures, we have a nature. It's inscribed. It's not something we create for ourselves. But we are able to imagine another course of events. We're able to imagine, for instance, what if I'm God of reality? And so the perennial temptation of man is to want to be the God of the universe. This is, in a different way, the devil's temptation. He doesn't want to serve God because he wants to be God. And the temptation that Adam and Eve face, if you go back and read the devil's temptation, he says, you'll be like God. It's, you know, deny that you're a creature, treat yourself as God. And I would suggest, and this is, I don't know, maybe a little provocative, that we see this every day. You know, there's the famous line in Planned Parenthood v. Casey that the heart of freedom is the ability to define one's own reality. That's a misconception of freedom, that I'm not truly free unless I'm the God of the universe and can create my own reality the way God does. I get to redefine language. I get to redefine gender. I get to redefine fill in the blank. I get to recreate everything and make it in my own image and likeness, make reality the way I want it to be made. That's the temptation that is symbolized in the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, to not treat myself as a creature, but to treat myself as a creator. Because you have reason, because you have intellect, you can delude yourself in that way. If you didn't have reason, if you didn't have intellect, you wouldn't even be tempted towards that. Like, an animal doesn't think, maybe I'm the God of the universe, because it doesn't have enough reason to even have that question cross the threshold. But because you've been given these tremendous gifts of intellect and will, you are inherently capable of that temptation. I don't know a way that God could create creatures with intellect and will without creating the possibility that they will use that intellect and will in a way that is contrary to what God desires. So I think that's at the heart of it. So the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, the Catechism doesn't treat it as a literal physical tree, but is rather a way of expressing this inherent problem in the human condition, that because you're rational, you're capable of denying your own creatureliness. Is that clarifying? Does that make sense?
Yes, that makes a lot more sense.
Good.
Eric, thanks. Appreciate that call. Let's go to Luis now. We promised we would. Luis, in Rhode Island, watching on YouTube, you are next. Luis, go ahead with your question for Joe.
Thank you, Sai, and hello, Joe. A huge fan. I was just looking for resources regarding homilies written by saints, something like the Catena Aurea. I think that's how you pronounce it. I don't know. By St. Thomas, but like with more modern saints.
Oh, yeah. That's a great question. The first thing that jumps out to me is St. Jose Maria Escriva has a book called Friends of God, which is all a series of homilies that he's given. Honestly, one of the easiest things to do, if there's a particular saint that you have a devotion to who's a priest, if you type in that saint's name and the word homilies afterwards in Google, there's a really good likelihood that if they've got written homilies out there, you will find them immediately. So the question is really, like, who are the saints to whom you have a devotion? Because if you're looking for the homilies of, like, the Curia of Ars or the homilies of Alphonsus Liguori or something, you can find those usually very easily. If you're looking for, you know, Augustine's got a bunch of homilies. I know that you said newer saints. But the idea of being very simply, whoever you have a devotion to, if they preached, chances are good. We've got a record of that preaching, and it's usually available for free. If not, you can at least find the book in which you can find it.
Yeah, sounds great.
Luis, I don't know if you say this.
Is there anyone? Oh, I'm sorry.
No, I don't usually say this. But I do think I can improve on Joe's answer. there's a book called Sermons in Times of Crisis, 12 Homilies to Stir Your Soul by Father Paul Scalia. And this won't do everything you want done, but he picked 12 of the best homilies ever given in the history of the church and assembled them into one book. And they really are great. They're fantastic.
That is an improvement on my answer. I didn't even know that book existed.
Is it really?
Oh. Yeah, no, I think that's a great answer. And, you know, the other thing, Luis, is that can also introduce you to a really good preacher, someone who really resonates with your soul. And then I would say, go punch that into Google and see if you can find more homilies they've written.
Luis, you were going to say something. I kind of stepped on your... go ahead.
No worries. Thank you. I was just saying, Joe, besides Jose Maria Escrivá, is there a saint who you would actually recommend?
Jose Maria would be my first immediate choice. Saint John Henry Newman has a bunch of homilies. He's a little more technical because he's writing for like a British 19th century audience. So occasionally it's not the way we would speak today. But I think his homilies are great. And I love the homilies of like Pope John Paul II, which are available on the Vatican's website. I think those are often really beautiful and profound. So those would be some good starter ones.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Thanks, Luis. Thank you very much. Let's see. I think we can get another question in here.
Oh, I think we can.
I'll tell you what. Thomas in Houston, Texas, listening on Guadalupe Radio Network. If you can be really quick, we can get you an answer. But you're going to have to be quite quick getting your question to Joe. Like, quicker than this. Do we have Thomas with us? What happened?
Thomas in Houston? Yes, I'm here.
Okay, go ahead. Real quick. Sure.
The question has been raised locally that permission by Rome and by the Vatican has been given for the ordination of women as priests. Is there any truth to that?
No, it's explicitly condemned and rejected as impossible. Pope John Paul II in Ordinatio Sacerdotalis in 1994 says, not only do we not have women priests, no pope has the ability to create women priests because Jesus didn't establish a co-ed priesthood. He establishes a male-only priesthood. So the deeper reason is why. And to that, I would say the reason is because to be a priest is more like being a father than it is like being like a doctor or a lawyer. Like if you think of the priesthood as a profession, well, profession should be open to anyone who's qualified, male or female. But if you think of a priesthood as vocational and relational, well, no woman, no matter how great she is, can be a dad. And no man, no matter how great he is, can be a mom. And so once you understand the priesthood is relational and vocational, then hopefully you can see why it's male only.
Thomas, thanks very much. Joe says those things about motherhood and fatherhood because he doesn't live in California. But nonetheless, Joe, good job on the... Don't forget, Joe's got a brand new podcast, Shameless Popery. It's out now. Just go to shamelessjoe.com and you can listen to Joe's fine new podcast, shamelessjoe.com. Joe, thanks. It's, as always, a really fun 2 hours.
Oh, thanks. My pleasure.
And I can't believe it, but that does it for us today. I don't like it, but I got to live with it. We'll see you next time, God willing, right here, Catholic Answers Live.